Coming up on today's show, we've covered what's coming for end users in information protection and email on recent shows. And now with the availability of Exchange Server 2016 preview, we'll do a first look review for admins. We'll take a look at how we have translated what we've learned from running the cloud at scale to improvements in performance and reliability for on-premises Exchange, including updates to connectivity and more. I'm joined by Greg Taylor, a longtime Exchange veteran. Now we're on the verge of releasing Exchange Server 2016. What can I expect as an Exchange admin?
Well, I think you can expect to see a lot of the work that we've done on Exchange Online coming to on-prem, features and innovations. You can expect to see a lot of the performance and administrative benefits, the things that we've learned while running a service coming to on-prem too.
And we have to learn a lot running at the scale that we run Exchange Online, right?
We learn every single day, right? So let's break this down into three key areas. And the first one we'll start with will be simplification.
Okay.
So if you take a look at the setup wizard for the new version of Exchange, there's something that should jump out and hit you straight away.
I think there's a few too few checkboxes. There's a CAS server role missing.
There is, right? And so the CAS server role as a separate installable role, the checkbox is gone, but it doesn't mean the CAS role itself is gone. So what we've done is we've simply co-located all of the CAS code onto the backend mailbox server, which, as it turns out, is what we've really been telling our customers to do since Exchange 2010. It's called multi-role Exchange. And really, it's come as a result of us learning this is really the best way to deploy Exchange. The roles happily coexist on the same box and make the best use of the hardware that's available to them. And so we've even gone so far as to instill it in what we call our preferred architecture.
So why is it better?
Well, we've learned that things fail, right? Disks fail and hardware fails. And so we have to account for that in our plans. And so our preferred architecture is based on how we deploy in Office 365, and we've built our best practice guidance into the product itself.
But how does getting rid of the CAS role impact failure?
Well, by getting rid of the CAS role, we can actually do two things. We can both reduce the server count, increase our availability, and improve our abilities to sustain failure. So let me give you an example. And let's just take rowing as an example. So in a typical email environment, you might have maybe 4 CAS and 10 mailbox servers, 14 servers in all. And let's imagine that the CAS servers are the rowers of the boat, keeping the connections moving along. And if one of the rowers, and we'll call him Jeremy, for no apparent reason other than because, you know, it was Jeremy.
Once in a while, I don't like to row.
He stopped rowing, right? And so the other three guys had to pull Jeremy's weight along with everybody else's, which seems a little unfair. Now, if we combine the roles, meaning we give everyone an oar, everyone's now a CAS and a mailbox server, everyone's pulling weight, and we can actually reduce the number of people in the boat. Because we can give everybody an oar, we can get rid of the individual CAS servers, we can reduce the server count to 12, or the rower count to 12, everyone's pulling an oar. Now when Jeremy decides he's just had about enough and he's gonna sit back and watch the world go by, when he gives up, there are 11 people who can take over the load. So by actually getting rid of the CAS role, we can decrease the number of servers, increase our availability, and our ability to recover or deal well with failure.
Very cool, and I can stop rowing.
Yeah, you can still row, yeah. And you did several times.
How does that actually convert, though, back to an Exchange architecture?
Well, it means that we have a simplified architecture, which also means simplified migration as well. So if we take migration, this is probably the easiest version of Exchange people will ever be able to migrate to. If they're coming from 2010, as we did with 2013 Exchange, you typically move the namespace across to the new version of Exchange, and the new version allows proxy back to the old. And there will really be no change from Exchange 2016 in that regard. But here's where it's kind of cool. If you've already got Exchange 2013, you can actually add an Exchange 2016 server to the environment. There's no need to move the namespace to the new version of Exchange. We will proxy up to the new version of Exchange from the 2013 Exchange server. And you have an incredibly easy way to migrate. All you gotta do is get the mailboxes to Exchange 2016.
Why don't you show us what it looks like in terms of the new Exchange admin console and how to really do those migrations?
Sure, so let's have a look at the Exchange admin center. Now, if you're an Exchange 2013 admin, this is gonna look really familiar. You have all the same settings down the left-hand side here for managing servers and mailboxes and mail flow and all of that. If you're coming from 2010, gonna look a bit new. but very straightforward, simple to use. We have our mailboxes and our, you know, meeting room resources and so on. But the area that you'll be hitting for the migration of mailboxes is simply this migration tab. And we have a nice easy wizard that allows you to move users to a different mailbox. And all you do, as you can imagine, is simply pick the users that you want to migrate. And we'll give our migration batch a name here. And we can even choose specific databases that we want to send the mailboxes to. However, if we don't, Exchange will actually take care of that find a mailbox database to send the mailbox to and take care of balancing them. And then we can either delay the start of the migration or just let it go ahead and be notified when it's finished. Now, generally, there's no impact to users here at all. We're doing online moves. So it's really simple, really smooth and fast.
Right. So that's really showing how we've simplified not only the architecture, but also the migration into the new version of Exchange. But what's the second area of focus that we've done in terms of Exchange Server 2016?
Well, the second area is reliability. And so what we've really done is we spent a lot of time analyzing the data we've obtained by running hundreds of thousands of servers with millions of mailboxes. And we've used that data to become experts in prediction of server failure, allowing us to see patterns where ordinarily we wouldn't have seen them in the past, and then to code into our servers some kind of self-healing capability so that they can detect and resolve failures themselves.
Right, because it's not really realistic to be able to send out somebody, a technician, to one of those hundreds of thousands of Exchange servers if something goes wrong. So we've actually got some great tools here that we can use to get more predictive about how and when and failure is going to happen and be able to prevent that.
Yeah, you bet. I mean, you know, the only thing you can really do with hundreds of thousands of servers is automation. You're entirely dependent upon it, letting the system figure out when there's an issue and hopefully resolving it. But we have built an enormous set of tools where we can, for example, as you can see here, we can look at the overall availability across all of our estate. We can have a look at individual DAG availability, and you might see red numbers and think that's bad. But when you see how many servers and how many DAGs we have running, you realize it's a drop in the ocean. We can, at a moment's glance, just look at the network bandwidth utilization and spot network issues. And we even get feedback from our clients as well, telling us how the client the responsiveness and reporting that back to us as well. We can see if there are issues with individual clients.
And all of this predictive data that we're getting is really the kind of a segue into how we can actually perform self-healing and really get the servers to be able to detect when something is going to go wrong, right?
Well, that's right. I mean, we introduced this as a concept and we called it managed availability in Exchange 2013. And the concept and typically the examples we used to use in 2013 was an OAuth server or a CAS server providing OAuth access to clients, where when the service became unresponsive based on latency or some kind of measure that we had, the server could self-correct and it would try a series of actions. Maybe it would restart the OAuth application pool. And if that didn't solve the problem, it might do an IIS reset. And if that didn't solve the problem, it might even restart the server.
Right.
So we shipped a lot of that technology, but we've been improving and honing it over time.
So baking really that logic in of an experienced Exchange technician right into Exchange server code. We've had managed availability for a while now. What's new in 2016?
Well, there's one interesting one I'd highlight, and it's a very rare condition, but it's pretty impactful. And so we've built something called database divergence detection into Exchange 2016. And this is this is code that allows us to detect logical corruption. So logical corruption might occur because of a disk controller failure, hardware failure or bug, maybe a memory issue. And so what we do is on the various copies of the database that we have, we calculate checksums for every single page on each database copy. And we ship them using the log shipping process that we have within the database availability group today from active to passive. And the passive nodes compare the checksums of their own copy of the database with that from the active and detect if divergence has occurred. Mm-hmm. And if divergence has occurred, that means there's a logical corruption either in the active or the passive. And we'll let the admin know this has happened, hopefully before the CEO calls them and tells them there's a problem with their mailbox. Right. And then the admin can take some action to resolve that.
Okay, so beyond what we're doing from a simplification reliability standpoint, what else are we doing?
Well, it's related to the same kind of concept of log shipping and databases within a DAG. One thing that we've done is we've made a change that we've actually been asked for several versions to make, which mm-hmm. is how we create our indexes. So on a passive copy of the database, we typically always created our search index from the active copy in many cases across the WAN.
So hold on, this is something a lot of people have been asking for many releases of Exchange.
Yes.
Now we're actually creating the search index against the passive copy of the data.
We are.
Okay,
yes.
Great.
Which is great. So we're lowering TCO. We hope there'll be a lot of happy admins from this change that we're making, yes.
We've also done a lot of improvements, speaking of indexing, in terms of search, right?
Well, we have. And again, it's about learning from the service. And we learn from the service by looking at search patterns that over maybe 600 million queries, I think we looked at the patterns. We learned interesting things about search. For example, we learned that people typically search for just one word, five or six characters. Commonly, they misspell words. So we actually have written code to optimize for those short, brief searches and for look for commonly misspelled words. So we actually are better at searching for that. And we also learned that people typically iterate on the same search over and over. And one in eight searches gets even no results at all. And we learned that speed is important. We've done a ton of work making improvements to the speed and responsiveness of search queries. And the best part, I think, of all of this is not just OWA. Outlook 2016, even in cache mode, is now searching against Exchange, so it can take advantage of all this work that we've done.
This is one of those really great things in terms of being able to see the telemetry, because in the old days, in the completely on-premises days, not a lot of people are turning on Watson reports or customer experience improvement programs. Now we can optimize search based on that production data.
Yeah.
But beyond search and indexing, we're also doing a lot in terms of addressing connectivity to the service, because I know a lot of people will call and say, well, why is my Outlook client not connecting to Exchange Server?
Well, that's been a problem that we've seen and suffered with for years. And we introduced in Exchange 2013 Service Pack 1 the MAPI over HTTP protocol. And we did that in order to help with these connections and reconnection speeds. And also is also a protocol that allows us to debug and troubleshoot connectivity problems much easier than we used to have with Outlook anyway. Now, we've continually improved this. And we are now seeing dramatic improvements in connection and reconnection times with Outlook to Exchange. And so this is not just Exchange 2016. These same improvements are back in 2013. And we would strongly encourage all our customers, if they've not already considered switching to MAPI over HTTP, that they should. It's the new default in 2016. That's how confident we are about it.
And I know a lot of people are probably wondering, well, what are the requirements looking like from a hardware perspective on Exchange? I know we've done a lot of work in terms of optimizing that for low cost, maybe existing hardware that people already have, right?
Well, definitely. I mean, running a service at scale means you have to optimize for the hardware you have and try and eke the maximum performance out of every single server you have. Otherwise, it becomes a not very, financially viable option, right? So we have seriously optimized Exchange for running on cheap commodity hardware, 2-socket, no more than 24 core hardware, cheap local storage, and all of these benefits that all of these investments we've made in the service to help us run a more cost-effective service show up in on-prem Exchange. So much so that we've actually updated our guidance for on-prem Exchange fairly recently so that we are recommending no more than 2 sockets and 24 cores in any Exchange server. The secret of successful Exchange deployments are about scaling out, not scaling up. And that's the biggest message, the biggest thing we've learned.
Great. So a lot of really good under-the-hood improvements for Exchange Server 2016 coming for admins out there. We're doing a lot of other things too, right?
Oh, we're doing a lot of other things. There's there's document collaboration improvements, SharePoint integration, data loss prevention, improved mobility experience. There's a whole ton of stuff that we're doing in Exchange as well.
And of course, the Exchange Server 2016 beta is now available to allow you to get an early look at some of these capabilities firsthand. And if you want to see more of what's coming for the email experience for users, check out some of our past shows on Outlook. So Greg, when will Exchange Server 2016 be available?
Well, when it's ready, and that'll be later this year.
Right, so keep watching Office Mechanics for more updates. That's about all the time we have for today. Thanks for watching, and goodbye for now.